Nelson Racing Engines, here to show you our series NRE University. What this series is going to do, it's going to show you guys a lot of the specialized equipment that we use to do what we do. And I figured we'd start it off with the cylinder head flow bench. I think it's important to point out all an engine is an air pump. So the more air you get in the motor, the more fuel you can burn. So the more air you get in, the more air you get out, the more power you're going to make. So I figured we'd start off with the flow bench. What the flow bench does is it tests how much airflow is running through your actual cylinder head. And in this case, we're actually developing an intake manifold called the X-Ram. So we're actually seeing how much airflow is actually running through the intake runner. You know, to do it really correctly, you want to check the entire intake track. And the cylinder head flow bench, you can do all of that. You can test just the cylinder head, you can test the cylinder head with the intake manifold, you can test the carburetor on here. It's a really a neat piece of equipment. This particular piece of equipment, Superflow, I've had it for years. I've spent a zillion hours on it, cylinder head porting and just adjusting things. And it really teaches you things you would think, oh, that would flow great. And then you put it on the bench and you're just distraught because it's not flowing all that great. So, at any rate, we're going to show you some of the basics of it and exactly kind of what it does. I know a lot of you probably already understand all of this, but I think it's important just to kind of go through and show you some of these things. So, right now what we have is I've taken an LS3 cylinder head and I've mounted it to a test stand. The bore size is 4155. So it's a big bore that we're testing on because the motor that we're going to put this intake on is a bigger bore. So 4155 bore, and we have the exact valves in the head, and we're going to see how much airflow is going past the valves, starting from 50,000 lift, and then we're going to go from 50 and 50,000 increments all the way up to 700 lift. So 50, 100, 150, 200. Just to give us an idea of how the air is moving across the valve and the total CFM at peak flow, or the total CFM at all the different valve lifts. It was a real eye-opener when I started using a flow bench, and it's something that is neat for you guys to see, I believe. One thing that we've done here is we've done a quarter 20 bolt. That's kind of neat because every revolution is roughly 50 thousandths. So I'm not going to use a dial indicator on this. When I depress the valve, I'm just going to go one turn, and in this instance, we're going to be repeating the same process on all the intake manifolds, so it's real easy to do, and it's kind of an old little trick, and it works pretty good for just going back to back. And at each increment, each 50,000th increment, I'm going to bring what's called a manometer. I'm going to bring it up to 28 inches of test pressure. We bring it up to the same test pressure each time. That way we get an accurate reading when we go to read our percent of flow. So I'm going to go ahead and basically test CFM is cubic feet per minute. So I'm going to test the cubic feet per minute throughout the lift range of the cylinder head. So let's go into some of the details of the bench itself. Okay, so right here we've got our manometers. The one closest to the right is what we're going to set our test pressure with. The one on the left, I use that manometer for probing the port and seeing where busy areas are in the port, etc. So if I can take a handheld probe, something like yay, and I can go and stick it in the port and kind of see where the air is flowing, where there's a lot of air flowing, where there's dead air, and that can kind of tell me where I can start if I want to, you know, start getting in there and grinding. Right here on the bench, we've got, if we're going to test intake or if we're going to test exhaust, we go ahead, let's say I want to test exhaust, I switch it to exhaust. How much CFM are we going to flow? So when we start the test, we'll be
below 150 CFM. So we'll set the bench over there. And as we start climbing, we'll go ahead and change that range to above 150 CFM. When we go on the intake side, we'll click it to the intake. And again, we'll start below 150 and then above 150. So these are some basic controls. Over here is your flow range. Now, each range is going to give you real high resolution up to a certain CFM. So range one is very low CFM, and as you start climbing your CFMs again here, it just allows you better resolution in between these ranges. Okay, another thing we got here is it's a calibration data. Now this is a edge orifice type bench, so we have a calibration plate. Each bench is slightly different, and it basically tells you in what range the intake and exhaust flow in percentage, and then you take that and multiply it by your actual percent of flow, and that gives you your cubic feet per minute readout. Over here, we've got a temperature gauge, and you know, you want to keep an eye on that because on the intake side, it's not a big deal, but on the exhaust side, as you start pushing, it can start getting hot, and that'll definitely change your number. Exhaust flow control. So what this is going to do is this is going to start adding flow, or actually, yeah, basically you're going to start putting air through your intake conduit, and you're going to bring it up test pressure. So by increasing or decreasing this knob, you're going to go ahead and increase or decrease your actual test pressure. That's for your exhaust flow, and you have one for your intake flow. So kind of get an overall view of the flow bench itself. And you can spend hours, days, weeks, months pulling your hair out, and then you find it and you just put a smile on your face. So we're going to go through and we're going to go ahead and test the intake port with the intake manifold on it. And right here we've got an intake and exhaust valve, and we've put some really light test springs on it, and we've just tapped, like I said, we've tapped this with a 1/4-20, and makes it real easy. Every revolution is 50 thousandths, and here we go.
All right, so I'm gonna start the flow test. First thing I like to do is I like to shut everything. I like to close the valves, make sure I got the spark plug in it, make sure, like, I almost forgot to put the injector in the bottom of the intake. And then I like to turn on the flow bench and then pull up the water pressure and see if we have a leak anywhere. So that's what I'll do first thing here. So I got it at around 34 inches of manifold vacuum, and I have no leaks because I can see they have no percentage of flow. So we've got a nice tight seal. Yeah. I just shut the flow bench off because we've at 100,000, so we're already out of the range of range 2. So I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to click over to range 3, and then I'm going to return the bench on and pull it up to 28 inches. Okay, 450,000 valve lift. We are now on range 5. Let's see how many times I can suck my shirt in this thing. So that's 650,000 valve lift right there. And then I will show you how we calculate this. So let's take a look at this. Okay, so at 50,000 valve lift, 28 inches of test pressure, we've got 53% of flow on range 2. We know that on range 2, the intake is 71.8. So we take this 71.8, we times 53% of flow and come up with a CFM number of 38 CFM. So we are moving 38 cubic feet per minute at 50,000 valve lift. We go ahead 50 times, we're on a different range right now, 151 equals 75.5 CFM. So at 100,000 valve lift, we're moving 75 CFM. 78.6, range 3, times 151, that's 118.6. 76.4 times 449, 343. 78 times 449, 350 CFM. For me, I'm really excited about this. We've done tons of work on this intake manifold, and it's exciting to see that it's 350 CFM at the end of the intake port, not at the beginning of the intake port, because normally you'll bolt on an intake on a good head, you'll lose 30 CFM. This particular head, it went 358 CFM. So we lost 8 CFM putting the intake on. And that is due to a good design. I mean, we made this particular intake because most LS intakes, this is a runner out of an LS intake. So if you come over here and you look at this runner, again, an engine, when you think about flow testing and everything else, an engine is just an air pump, right? So the more air you can get in, the more air you can get out, the more power you're gonna make. So every time you put bends in runners, it takes airflow away. So this particular runner is a common LS, you know, LS3 type manifold. And you can see how much bend it has to do, basically 180 degree bend to get airflow, where this is a much straighter shot into the intake port, and that's why we don't see a big intake flow variant. You might be asking, what is this monstrosity around the port? And what we do is we just take modeling clay and we break the edge. If you don't do that, it gets really noisy
and this edge here creates turbulence, and you'll get a really bad flow number. So we usually take clay and we kind of just, you know, finger mold it around. That way it just busts the edge. Of course, this isn't the most sexiest piece here, but it does the job for the purposes of this video.
Okay, so what we got before and after the intake manifold is we have a 365 CFM intake port, and with the intake manifold on, we have a 351 CFM intake port. So we've lost 14 CFM bolting on the intake manifold, and that's not too shabby for 13 inches of runner. Alright, so we're done flowing the intake, so now we're going to flow the exhaust port. And the difference is we're just, instead of sucking air in, we're going to blow air out the exhaust port. So I've closed the intake valve, I'm going to start opening the exhaust. I've closed up my intake control valve, I'm going to switch over to exhaust. I'm just going to put it above 150 CFM because we're going to, actually, I'm just going to put it above for right now. We can run the whole test that way. And here we go, let's do it. So when you flow the exhaust, you definitely have more temperature. So right there, I'm going to just jot down the temperature, about 110 degrees. Now, also to note, we're not testing this with a pipe. A lot of times I would put a pipe on it. It definitely changes the number. So when you put an exhaust pipe on it for the flow bench test, it will definitely change the number. This particular test, just for the video purposes, we didn't flow it with the pipe. But it is a good idea, if you know the primary diameter that you're gonna run, you can go ahead and flow it with that primary diameter, and that'll give you a more indicative number of what the flow is gonna be. So not really too bad a number. We've got 246 CFM without a pipe, and that's a pretty good number for an LS. With a pipe, it definitely would have been more. We would have been in the high 250 range, somewhere around there. You know, 360 odd CFM intake, 200 and almost 50 CFM exhaust, this baby's gonna run. One thing that we found on the flow bench is usually every CFM you find in the heads, in the intake and exhaust ports, if you get through the whole conduit and make an improvement through the whole conduit, not just, you know, an intake port with the manifold and everything else, you usually do see that on the dyno. So, you know, a flow bench is such a good piece of equipment to have, because you see an improvement here, you usually see it on the dyno, unless you just are just killing velocity, etc. Okay, so we just finished flowing the stock intake. We obviously don't have the throttle body on it, so we're going to have a better number right now than we would, but we'll see what that worked out to. So what we've got is 323 CFM. So we're picking up 28 CFM from this manifold. Actually, from the X-RAM to this manifold. And the reason being is, like we said, I mean, an engine is just an air pump. So what we did with the X-RAM is we straightened out the runner. So you no longer have this, you know, curved runner coming around. You've got a much straighter shot. You get more airflow, more power. So you can play around with the port. While the port's on at different lift levels, you can go in there and kind of see where it's busy when reading water pressure or how much it pulls in inches of water. And it can show you the areas that really could use some work. So that's kind of the basics, 1, 2, 3 of how to flow ahead. I want to actually jump into some really important things that not a lot of people overlook is low lift flow and the valve seat, because they are so important, and people just are always, when you think about a cylinder head port, you think about it being open and what it's like when the air is flowing full. But if you actually, you know, when the valve is at, let's say, 700 thousandths valve lift, if I was a little miniature guy, I could actually be standing on the valve stem and holding the valve stem, and there's not a lot of air actually happening at the valve stem. It's all coning around the valve itself. So we're going to try to light the port and show you the valve as it's opening. And you know, it's spent, the motor spends so much time, you remember, it only hits max lift once, but it goes by the low lift twice because it has to open and close. So your low and mid lift is super important for a motor to run good.
Okay, so that's at 150 thousandths valve lift. And you can see that there's just not much area for the air to get around that valve. So I'm going to turn the bench on, and we're going to open up the valve through the sequence here. So there's the valve at max lift. That's 650 thousandths lift right there. And you can see it's a much different, the port has to work very different in the low, this is really pretty shitty in focus here, but there we go. So at low and mid lift, your flow is really dependent on your valve job in, you know, the beginnings of the bowl. At higher lift, the port actually comes into, you know, into working. So I just wanted to film that and show you guys, because I don't care how good a port you have. If you don't have a good valve job, your low and mid lift is going to be suffering. You know, your valve job, your low and mid is really, you know, let's say, call it 0 to 300 thousandths valve lift. And like I said, no matter how good the port is, the valve seat is just as important. Okay, we're staring at the a chamber of a bone stock LS3. So this is what you would call your combustion chamber. This dictates, it has a specific volume, which it helps with the, this and the piston and your stroke and everything else. This is how you calculate your compression ratio. But beyond that, what I really want to show you here is this is your valve job. You've got, you know what, go give me that pointer. Yeah. Okay. No, too hot. No light. Yeah, no light. Okay, right here is your top cut, usually 30 degrees. We move on, that's your 45 degree seat. That's your ceiling surface. And then here's your bottom cut, usually 60 degrees. But that's the magic of a valve job, is changing all these angles.
So your throat diameter in here, your bottom angle, your ceiling angle, and your top angle. These are super important, super important. Same thing on the exhaust. You can see these multi-angle on the exhaust here. Again, you got your top cut, your ceiling cut, 45, your bottom cut, and then into your throat, okay? On the valve itself, you've got your, here, hold the camera. On the valve itself, you've got your 45, and we've done a 30 degree back cut right here. And so that at low lifts, it helps the air get around this. Now, just to show you, again, from this side of the ball, right here, let's just put the valves in here. Okay, if you're talking, let's say that's 150 thousandths lift, this is the only place that the air gets out of the valve. So how you turn that air and how you get that air around that valve is super important. Same thing with the exhaust valve. Of course, now at 650 thousandths lift, I don't know if this is, let's just say this is roughly 650 thousandths. It's a whole nother ball game because you have all this area around here. But again, the air has to get around this valve. It's not just coming out the center where you think cylinder head flow. It has to get by this valve. So again, I'm just, you know, I guess saying it so much, but valve shape, valve job, the valve, all the angles that you pick, there's a good little amount of kernel of horsepower in all of that, and I just wanted to point that out. Even the way, like this little back cut right here, this little back cut, from 0 to 300 thousandths lift, it's worth a ton of little. I mean, I've seen 15 CFM increase just from that little cut right there. So, pretty neat piece of little information.
All right, guys, I know there's definitely not enough time to cover everything, but hopefully you learned something, and we're going to start this series and do it with everything in the shop. We're going to do it with the machines in the engine shop. We're going to do it on the fabrication side. And I think it's really going to be cool because it's going to be able to let me bring you guys into the shop and show you how we do it. And I think it'll be fun. Thanks for watching.